Hello everyone, welcome to the second episode of Creative Writers and Illustrators. Today I'm going to be talking about this book, which has three of my favorite entities. It has been released by Bombay Natural History Society. It is written by Katie Barkley and illustrated by Zainab Tambawala. Say hello everyone.
Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah. So there will be a lot more promotion from the author and the illustrator. So I just want to start off by asking some questions to both of them. This book is called Flight of the Pink-Headed Ducks and Other Stories. It's a collection of five short stories, 3,500 word length, Katie, each?
Approximately.
Approximately,
yes.
Right? It's a book on conservation. It's a book on the endangered species in the subcontinent. It has got two stories, one from Bangladesh and the other from Myanmar. The rest of the three stories are from India, right?
Yes.
Yes. So, Katie, there is a pink embroidered duck in the book. Yeah?
Yeah.
So, did the book fuel the idea of making this embroidered duck, or did the embroidered duck lead you to the story?
That's a good question. No, actually the story led me into doing this embroidered duck.
Okay.
And the reason is, I mean, if you want to know, I wanted to keep myself occupied because after writing the book, I had to undergo knee surgery. So while I was at the hospital, I did this, you know, just for the fun of it.
Okay. Zainab, I love this book. Every picture in the book is a prompt in itself. A child can just, look at one picture and create a story entirely.
Thank you.
You know, it's just beautiful. You know, I mean, I just want to show... There's something, you know, this is my favorite picture. I mean, this is
mine
so
too.
Beautiful.
Mine also.
So beautiful.
Yes.
Thank you.
Very nice.
So can you tell us something about the creation of the illustrations? Yeah, I noticed that, you know, you have used a variety of, it does not have a single fixed medium throughout the book, right? You have played, or I mean, you seem to have enjoyed yourself using a whole lot of mediums.
Yes, so that was my intention. My intention was to basically create variety in the art. One, for my own self. Mm-hmm. And two, is also respond to the story. Because I felt that every story that I read needed a different response. And I probably could not imagine the same thing in the same different things in the same medium. So I like for the dolphin, you know, just the fact that the dolphin is endangered because of the garbage that is, you know, thrown, yes, in the Ganga, that just that prompted me to use a collage of, you know, textures and things which would create that effect. So I think my response to an artwork comes from the story itself and what the story inspires me to do. So that's the reason why I used several different mediums. Yeah.
You're on mute. Shyamala, you're on mute. We can't hear.
So there are a whole lot of endangered species in the book. I mean, not just in the book, in the world and in the Indian subcontinent. So how did you choose these five? What made you choose these five endangered species?
The great Indian bustard, I had to select because it is really on the brink of extinction. There are just a few hundred left.
Hmm.
And then the others I selected because of the varying habitats, like a river or a forest for the red panda, you know, grasslands, of course, for the great Indian bustard. And it was again the river for the, and the marshy swamps for the pink-headed duck. So it brought that into background also, that even the habitats are being affected for these endangered species.
Which of these five animals did you enjoy drawing, and which one gave you a bit of discomfort, Zainab?
The pink-headed duck gave me a little bit of discomfort, for the simple reason is that there was no real documentation on how it looked. So there were some botanical prints from very, very long ago, and all the documentation on the duck looked very different from each other. But the thing here is that BNHS is so particular, and BNHS has such great inputs, okay, that they knew exactly what they were looking for. So they knew exactly how the head of the duck had to be shaped. So the reason why it took me really long to finish that particular story is because I really had no references. So I was going with the reference of a regular duck, but trying to imagine the pink-headed duck. And that took me a little, like that really put me off, because there was really no, like, you know, even in flight, what sort of flight, yes, or how much, you know, how much do their wings really spread out? What is the size? All of that really matters when you create a visual. And that's one thing I had a problem with. The others, I was very comfortable. I didn't have any issues. The snow leopard was fun. Again, because I used color pencil and I worked in color pencil after a very long time. I used a lot of online references, and Katie had some amazing pictures of the snow leopard being captured exactly like this. So all of that really, you know, helped me put the image together.
Katie, what was your...
Yeah,
you
sorry.
Something, Katie? Yeah, please go ahead.
No, I was just saying, I don't think there are any recorded photographs of the pink-headed duck, right? There were only illustrations done long ago.
There are a couple of black and white pictures, but they are just from one angle. So you really can't tell much. And BNHS also has a preserved this of the pink-headed duck, but because you know they need it more for recording other things, it's a completely flattened out model. So I got the the shape and stuff of the head, but I couldn't really tell the height or the form of the neck and stuff like that.
Katie, what was the hardest part of writing this book?
The hardest part.
I mean, I can see everything came from the heart. You know, the language is
absolutely
effortlessly, and I simply love the metaphors you used in the book.
I don't remember any hard part as such, as you say.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, as you said, it came from the heart and I feel for it.
Yeah.
So it just flowed, you know. Yeah. I especially enjoyed writing the first story, The Pink-Headed Duck. And even the Ganges River dolphin, because it is in the river of many moods and, you know, that sort of a thing. So it wasn't really.
Because one of the stories is based in Myanmar and the other is based in Burma. And the setting is an important part of the story. So how did you go around researching that?
From various books which I had read, even story books which I had read earlier. Actually, there was a book many years ago which I had read, In Search of the Pink-Headed Duck. And that, at that time, I was really young. And I remember being really inspired by that story. And it was there at the back of my mind all the while. And so the book began with this story again, you know, with a different version of it.
Zainab, I think this is the best illustration in the book. What were you thinking when you were, when you were making this? I mean, what was there something which resonated with you?
So for me, whenever I read a story Okay, I usually just get transformed or transported to the time and space and the visuals that actually, you know, evoke or, you know, create emotions in the story. So with the way Katie had described the whole thing in words, the visuals just sort of start appearing for me. So, and when that happens, my my goal is to create the atmosphere or the mood that I really want to portray. So I think that that whole idea of the moonlighting and everything just came from there.
Can you tell me a bit about
the way someone is taking a picture on the mobile phone?
Yeah. It just captures. that's the other
the realities.
Yeah, that's the other picture in the book, you know. Yeah,
that is very interesting.
This one.
Yes.
Beautifully captures the book. So, what art medium have you used here? Are they
for the story of the Great Indian Bustard? I've used gouache.
Okay. You have to give us some more details, okay? Because that is to be too technical for layman people like that.
Yes.
I usually work in watercolors. This is just a slightly more opaque medium. Okay. I've always wanted to try it out. So honestly, this was the first time I've ever used gouache in this, in illustration.
So it is something like poster, but not poster colors.
Yeah, it is. It's poster colors is a slightly more student material. Gouache is a slightly more artist material. Yeah.
Okay.
It's a nice transition between watercolor and poster color.
It's come out beautifully. Absolutely. It just captures the mood, the colors and the characters. I mean, it just puts the spotlight on the Great Indian Bustard.
Quite an enchanting scene.
Yes. You know, you can look at the biggest thing about these pictures is that each one, you know, you take out the story. You just look at the pictures individually and a child can come up with a totally different story. You know, that's the magic Zainab has woven through all the pictures.
Right.
Thank you so much.
Katie, you know, the four stories in the book, they're all written from the third viewpoint. But the last story, the singing dolphins, has been written in the first viewpoint. It's like, is it close? You know, for a while, I thought maybe this is from your childhood or, you know, or that's, I think that's the beauty of the writing that, you know, you kind of tell the reader that, this could be my story kind of things.
It was just to change the perspective. Like Zainab had different styles of art. Yeah. I decided to put the story in that form. In fact, if you see, even the snow leopard has a sort of a mystical, you know, feeling to it because there's a mountain spirit talking to the snow leopard and guiding it all the while.
Yes.
So just to add to that, you know, different kinds of perspectives.
Zainab, there's a reference image credit given to Siddhesh Brahmankar. I'm not able to get the context as to, you know, how it's being used in the book. If you can just throw some light.
To whom the credit is to?
He's given it to Siddhesh Brahmankar, the great
for Indian bustard. For the bustard?
Yeah, for the bustard.
Yeah, that's because BNHS had lent me a book which had a picture by that photographer for the reference of the for the bustard.
Okay.
For the reference of the bustard, yeah. So I've used that reference as is.
Okay. It's in all the three or any particular image?
I think it's for the image where the villagers are looking at the bustard in the night.
Bustard. Yeah. Right. I mean, it's a pretty like proud posing bustard.
that's its courtship display, you know, when it
calls
out and bones away.
Not that particular image, the very first image. I think that's the one that's been given credit to.
This is the first image for the particular story. So this is the one you're talking about, right? Katie, I think you're talking about this.
Yeah, the one.
The one where it's.
Yes. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So you've written about insects, you've written about birds, you've written about animals, you know, all kinds of animals now. What's left?
Well, right now I'm writing about the different kinds of fungi.
Oh, great. Okay.
Because it's something which people hardly, you know about and hardly think about. And it's quite fascinating. We have so many thousands and thousands of types of fungi. So trying to create stories out of those.
Right. Zena, what was your biggest takeaway from creating illustrations for the book? I mean, you've done hundreds of animals from your imagination, from, you know, looking at images from other sources and making it, right? But this process was completely different than what you have done before.
Yeah, so because this was also coming through BNHS, there had to be a certain, you know, they needed to follow like a certain amount of likeness to the animal and stuff like that. So they needed everything to be like absolutely perfect. No miscommunication.
Yes.
No communication of any features or, you know, any distortion in the in the proportions or anything. So that itself was just one learning. The other thing is that I think I've known Katie for a really long time. I know how passionate Katie is about what she does. And I've gone out several times with Katie for nature walks and things like that. I myself, you know, I'm a nature lover and very conscious and aware about, you know, things around me. So this for me was a dream to do, you know, because it was just my way of putting something out which, you know, which really matters, which makes a difference.
Yeah. So, you know, I think this is a fabulous collaboration between three wonderful entities. You know, each one stands for something. Each one is a specialist. Right? So I think it's a beautiful book. Which is your favorite story, Zena, from this book?
I honestly love all of them. I just love all of them.
I'm glad you don't dislike any of
them. I love all of them. I love all of them because I have actually almost created, you know, I've created the storytelling for it. So I've gone into every story. I've been a part of every story. So I don't think I can pick a favorite.
Okay.
No.
For me, each of them is equally important. It's just like Katie would have, you know, probably not had a favorite because she went into each one of them. Yeah. So it's for me, it's the same. It's the same. Each one is equally important. If there was a favorite for me, it would have reflected in the illustrations. And I think that all the illustrations are at par.
Absolutely.
So I think that itself speaks.
Yeah, right. You have given individuality to every story, you know, with your illustrations.
Yes.
Katie, The Great Indian Bustard, you know, at some point I felt that maybe this is inspired by real life. Is it?
No. It was.
Is there a
it
statue?
Was not fiction.
Is there a statue for the.
That no.
Part? No. No. No.
There
okay.
isn't.
Okay.
It's all just created.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's what, you know, that's the beauty of your writing, that you make the reader feel that, yes, this could be true.
The only small thing you can say which could have inspired is sometime back, you know, I've attended so many lectures by BNHS people, and in their effort to conserve, they always appeal to the sentiments of the people.
Yes.
So, for example, they would put a picture of the Great Indian Bustard or a statue of the Great Indian Bustard in their temples, you know, to show that this is so great, it deserves to be worshipped. So that people, you know, conserve it.
Right.
So maybe that feeling must have inspired. Otherwise, it's all creative, the story.
There are a few songs in the book. Are they set to tune? Do you want to sing any one of them?
No, they haven't been set to tune. Yeah. You can set them to any tune and sing them.
Okay. I think they've come out very beautifully. You know, so thank you. Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Zena.
Oh.
And I I would like the viewers to buy this book. It's available. It will be available on the BNHS site, right?
Yes. And it must be already on Amazon.
It's already.
If not, it will be very soon. They're putting it up on Amazon.
Yeah. So you can get your copy on www.bnhs.org. Amazon as well. If you have any requirements, you can reach out to your local independent bookstore, and I'm sure they will be able to get you this copy, right? Thank you all for joining, right? And BNHS does a lot of other stuff too. Apart from creating books, they have a fabulous library with a wonderful collection, and the entire library staff is like, it's like super cooperative and very helpful.
Absolutely. Yes.
Do go and check out their resources. They are also into nature trails. So once the season